go back to bone marrow transplantation or hematopoietic stem cell transplantation, Tiller McCulloch. They did all their experiments in inbred mice, so there was no transplantation barrier. In a bone marrow transplant, if you have a transplant autologous, that's from the same patient, that's fine, it'll work. If it's heterologous, it can be okay if you can get the transplantation to take, if there's no rejection, or if you can suppress the rejection, or if you can get a perfect match, but it can be dodgy. And the other piece of information is that stem cells are able to regenerate a complete tissue forever. So these types of treatments could be extremely effective if properly applied. There are, however, grave problems if you get the tissue matching wrong, and the graft versus host disease seen after an inappropriately matched bone marrow transplantation, and this is just an example of the really terrible attack of the immune system on the host, is a good example of how you have to get these things right and how probably you do want to use autologous cells if possible. So what is the sort of scenario? Suppose a patient has a heart attack. Now, here's a patient. It would be very nice. The heart muscle does regenerate, but only very slowly. It used to be thought it doesn't, but it does. But there's clearly insufficient cells being made to restore the heart muscle after a heart attack. Some small number of animal experiments have shown that if you have heart muscle precursor cells, you can add them back to a damaged heart, and they will help to regenerate the muscle in the heart. Now, could we find in this patient other cells that we could put into the heart to repair it? And can we find a source of embryonic stem cells from which we could get heart muscle cells? Now, in this scenario, I'm using the suggestion that we could use a cell nuclear replacement. This is a cloning technique where you put the nucleus from a differentiated cell into an oocyte to get that to develop, and then get from that an embryonic stem cell culture. Come back to other possibilities there. Obviously, the embryonic stem cells themselves are no good. You've got to use them to bulk it up, but you've then got to get a differentiated, refined product, in this case, the specific heart muscle precursor cells in a purified population. It's taken back, and the young lady is okay. Slightly old lady in my diagram, I think. But how can we do that? Now, that's depending upon a cell nuclear replacement. Did you see that? This is how we do it without. What we need is a bit of magic there. And indeed, there are bits of magic coming along. So let's just think about the ESL-based cellular therapeutics. All these steps actually are feasible. It's a sound vision. The total scenario has only been put together in some rather few, rather careful animal models. But overall, you can see that all the parts of it can work. There are a lot of ethical dilemmas. Ethical dilemmas on sourcing the embryonic stem cells from embryos. I'm not going to that in great detail here. But there are other ethical dilemmas which are much more pertinent to medical treatment, and that is that they must have proper safety, proper efficacy, and proper legal controls. There are many potential benefits, but we need, these are very, very early days. This is a vision, this is not a reality at the moment. What about the biotechnology opportunities? Well, the grand scheme of things may give opportunities, but I do like to point out at this sort of stage that really a lot of these developmental technologies are going to give all sorts of opportunities for the, what you might almost call the ancillary companies, but the reagent developing companies, the companies who will provide the laboratory containment facilities, et cetera, et cetera. So there's a lot of opportunity, which is perhaps not in the grand scheme, but is part of the grand scheme. Now, what about sources of human embryonic stem cells? In order to get patient-specific cells, or in order to provide a sufficiently large bank of cells from which we can select histocompatible cells for any particular patient, we need to be able to generate lots of ES cell lines. We need to be able to generate them efficiently. Now, probably also need to be able to regenerate them from particular genetic cellular sources. The so-called therapeutic cloning, the cell nuclear replacement, we can have a bank of cells. We can have the bank of ES cells is going to be really very inefficient for any particular treatment, because you have a patient, you want one particular precursor cell population in purified, verified form. If you have the matching ES cell, you still have to go through all of the development of the precursor that you want. So maybe those banks that at the moment are being established of ES cells have got to be very much enlarged in the future to have 10 or 20 different purified precursor cell populations from each initial genetic source. Then what do we do about the immune rejection? I'm talking about, first of all, getting patient-specific or patient-matched, but maybe we can use immunologically privileged sites, and indeed some of the early phase work is going on in transplantation into the brain, for instance, and into the eye, both of which are immunologically privileged and will give a better opportunity. Autologous cells, reprogramming, time and cost. Now, this is a diagram that I used some years ago of the cell nuclear replacement. What we now have, adding to that, are the remarkable observations of Yamanaka in Japan and others following him on, showing that it's possible to take an adult cell and to get it by essentially manipulating the transcription factors, manipulating the whole cell behavior. Yamanaka put four transcription factors in retroviral vectors in. There have been some developments from that, but essentially that's what's being done. You can make an induced pluripotential cell. So you can skip all that business of worrying about finding oocytes, doing micromanipulative nuclear transplantation, worrying about then having an embryo from which you make stem cells, etc. You can skip it. You can go in one major jump. And that, of course, now opens up the idea that you can transdifferentiate cells. I said right at the beginning that typically cells do not move from one pathway to another. But this is an example. The Yamanaka induced pluripotent cells is an example of how you can do perhaps the biggest jump that you can imagine. You can take a skin biopsy from an adult, and then you can, by manipulation of transcription factors, by careful culture methods, you can move it right back to an early embryo state. So if you can do that, the door is open. The ideas are there for possibly doing, a move from your skin biopsy, say, direct to the heart cell you want. In other words, one major jump in another direction.